Mini chapter 104. The beasts converge on Sandpiper Street. Herb opens a third window over the west side, through which he zooms in on a wide boulevard somewhat east of LAX, hurtling the viewpoint ever down until the flatly styled, retro-flavoured allure of its office buildings, street surface markings and palm trees stands out crisp. At the appointed moment, the remaining three beasts are summoned forward across Jamie's study, where they swing themselves up across the desk and slip in through the monitor, one by one. Shimmering into focus together, Shigem and Kim and Evelyn find themselves stepping up from the curb of West Century Boulevard into a bus whose destination is lit up in three letters, LAX. Moving down the aisle, Shigem sees the only available seat is next to a surly old man whose bag is half occupying the seat. "May I?" Shigem asks, indicating the bag. The old man moves the bag off after a second. Shigem nods thanks and sits down, emitting a sigh of fatigue as he does so, since it happens he's been on his feet for quite a while today. The man mumbles something not quite audible. "I'm sorry?" Shigem asks, inclining his head towards him. The old man growls in reply as he repeats himself, "Is there going to be a lot of sighing?" Shigem looks at him for a few moments, then realizes he must be referring to Shigem's sigh of fatigue upon sitting down just now. The evident assumption that this sigh was caused by the man's slowness in moving his bag is so silly that Shigem just speaks aloud his own reflex, "Oh, please!" Like a shot, the man rasps back, "Lady, cool it!" Shigem's mouth falls open. How even more ridiculously silly! It's clear, however, that the situation is quite unsalvageable already, after no more than a couple of exchanges each. Reflecting on this unsalvageability, Shigem is bored, irritated, and amused in such equal measures that he finds his urge to express each of these three emotions is precisely cancelled out. The only thing to do is to whip out a book from his shoulder bag and stare into it with a furious cool, which he proceeds to do. So little is he focusing on the book's pages, however, what with all this ridiculousness, not to mention the flustered indignation beneath his furious cool, that several more seconds elapse before it occurs to Shigem that he should perhaps check whether he is holding the book the right way up. But too late, alas. "You may want to hold the book the right way up," growls the man dryly. "Oh, that does it," says Shigem, standing up again. "I didn't want to sit down anyway." "Great, I'll take your seat," says Kim, and sits in his place. "Thanks for warming it up." Hearing a trio of incoming text bleeps, the three of them check their mobile phones. It's Jamie, sending them the coordinates of the server farm. It is time for their mission. "Hold on," says Evelyn. "These coordinates are in the middle of nowhere, beyond the far end of the airport, and this bus only goes to the middle of the airport. That'll be such a hike. Who walks that kind of thing?" "Not us," says Shigem. "What does Jamie take us for?" "We'll catch a cab from where the bus terminates." And so it is that a cab glides to a stop, half an hour later, just beyond LAX, on a deserted stretch of Pershing Drive. The three of them alight. Up Sandpiper Street they go, to the top of the bare slope, where they see a low structure. Its unlocked door reveals a small lobby, where Amber and the Platinum Raven are standing in contemplation of the downward-pointing arrow on the single button beside the lift doors. The five beasts all high-five. Then they step back in a line, all in character, hands on hips or by their side or arms folded, heroes on a mission. Amber steps forward, presses the lift button, then turns to the others with his forefinger to his lips. "From now on, until we get downstairs into the server farm, let's stay silent," he instructs. "There may be security guards." "Oh boy. No, in that case, I think I'd better wait here," says Shigem. "Why?" asks Evelyn. "Because whenever I have to be silent, I get hiccups. It doesn't happen straight away, but as soon as the need for silence arrives, so do the hiccups. I feel them forming an orderly queue until they're all bunched up in the upper part of my trunk. That's a little traumatic in itself, because I have quite a sensitive trunk, as you'd imagine, but the main danger is even worse. Just when the room is dead quiet, a violent hiccup pops up, and I have to take aim and stifle it with the right timing, or else it's super loud. Okay, so that's all very well so far, but then all I can do is count the seconds until the next one. And soon enough, I just know that some hiccup is going to manage to get past me, and everyone will turn round and stare, and I'll go all pink and have to run out of the room and find upside-down water before it happens again. Oh God, being me is such a constant trauma. You've no idea. So, no, I'd better be brave and wait here. It's true, chips in Kim. Okay, says Evelyn. Sorry, I had no idea you have to go through all that. Well, oh, Jesus wept. For fuck's sake, get down there with the rest of us and stop being such a wuss. The pain, the anguish, the endless poetry, says Kim. Shh, warns Amber fiercely. Get it together, please. The lift arrives and the doors open. Okay then, let's hit it. In bold stepping unison, they stride forward into the lift, halt and swivel in formation, so as to face back towards the open lift doors. Amber presses the down button on the wall of the lift, then stands with his feet planted wide, braced for whatever fast-moving action may be just about to happen. The lift doors remain immobile for several long seconds. Then slowly, very slowly, they slide to a close. The lift descends and coasts to a standstill. The doors reopen to reveal the enormity of the Bangdead server farm in the hall ahead, thus bringing the five of them to the hilltop crest, as it were, where they're on the tipping point before sliding down from being beasts in a decorative landscape into being programmed embodiments of Jamie's repurposing the stuff of the news feeds. As that forward downsliding takes control of their feet at the threshold of the lift, they feel Herb's code running through them like electricity, along with Jamie's words when he prophesied this very feeling. Let it happen. Dance with it in grace, if you please. So they each take an aisle up the warehouse-sized hall, where they stalk and swagger, flaunt and prowl, along between the stacks, still able to feel the weight of their own sexy beast physicality on the polished concrete floor, but increasingly able to perceive the dance of billions of glyphs and pixels filling up the servers around them, where the full horror of the Ain't They Freaky news feeds lives enwrapped in Kelly's crude visuals, held aloft in infinitesimal galaxies of impassive ones and zeros. They emerge from the far ends of their chosen aisles and converge in the space beyond. Okay, gather round, says Shigem in a stage whisper, and for want of any competing instructions, the others all obey. Now, brace yourselves for the following suggestion, because it's just a girlish whim and we don't have to do it, but wouldn't this be the ideal venue for a club night? I think this is the ideal opportunity for such a night, and I'm about to tell you why you should too. We're sliding into code here, as Jamie promised. I can feel it happening, can you? His companions nod, looking more spacey every minute. We are about to nuke out some hardcore poison from these servers and channel it all along those artwork cyberpipes and pipelines into tanks of clean raw stuff. It'll be dirty work, so let's spice it up into a club night, what'd you say? Okay, so it'll probably devolve into a scenario of bitchy, faggy, ironic, limp sassiness, but it's worth a shot. Or we could just all plough on miserably ahead if you prefer. Oh, I just can't decide which. You choose. Club night, shouts Evelyn. Okay, you've persuaded me, says Shigem. I tell you, it'll be so fierce. I'll float around the club with a constant pout like a kiss, and you'll be all tarted up like a dyed chihuahua. That's not quite the look I was planning, she says, but I'm right behind you on the club night idea. All right, let's go, he announces, hugging her and Kim, then pulling the other two into their embrace.